All right, my panel is back with me now. I'm going to start with you, Nia Malika Henderson. At the president's rally over the weekend, President Trump implied that there had been a terror incident in Sweden. He was wrong, but the president doubled down anyway on Twitter. He said, give the public a break. The fake media, fake news media, is trying to say that large-scale immigration in Sweden is working out just beautifully. Not. So he said what he said. We heard what he said. And then we know what the facts bear out. But when you have Pence, right, the vice president, and you have Secretary Mattis trying to reassure our allies, especially in Europe, does this hurt those efforts?
You know, it certainly complicates them. I mean, it makes their job much more difficult in terms of the message they're carrying, in contradiction to what the president says. And we saw that play out in any number of issues. President Trump talking about he's a fan of NATO, but and then Pence going over there and sort of giving this full-throated embrace of NATO. So there isn't a singular message coming out of this White House. There is no Trump doctrine yet. And given it's only 4 weeks into this presidency, it's a little early for that. But I think it also goes to the fact that even as a candidate, Donald Trump could be all over the place in terms of his foreign policy. At one point, he could sound very hawkish. At other points, he could sound very libertarian in terms of America's engagement in the world. And I think we're seeing that play out. Many different messages coming out of this White House in terms of engagement with allies and opponents. And one of the things you've seen, you've had people from Russia, for instance, Pushkov, say there are three different messages coming out of this White House. And into sort of that gap, you have Russia basically feeling emboldened in terms of where their position is in Europe. So I think it is problematic. We'll see if it changes. I think in some ways it's consistent with the president we've seen so far. But my goodness, if you are all of these folks overseas, whether you're Pence or Mattis, you're very much on cleanup duty in terms of a kind of softening what the president says, and not sure if, you know, he'll tweet something in contradiction to what they've said. And I think the other thing about Donald Trump is he very much sees these relationships as deals, right? He talks about maybe he can make a deal with Russia, and he sees them very much one-on-one. Even when he talks about trade deals, the whole idea of sort of a multilateral relationship, which is what foreign policy is, he doesn't really see it that way. He doesn't understand if you make a deal with Russia, that means something for the West in terms of Europe. Yeah. So, you know, there's some on-the-job learning I think he's got to do.
General, we've heard from several officials in Sweden. We know how they feel about it, but what does this do for us internationally, especially when it comes to national security?
I think the biggest concern that I have right now is that the notion of making America great again and America first has a very strong connotation toward bilateralism. America is first in this particular instance, whatever this is. It's America first in its dealing, its trade dealing, let's say, with China or whatever it is. The concern that I have with that is that begins to create daylight in these multiple bilateral relationships, where heretofore what we've had with the EU, for example, is a contiguous body that has signed up for an agreed set of principles and values, an economic system, and a national security perspective that has been wrapped with NATO and different elements within the EU. That's healthy. My concern is that that begins to atrophy if we continue to push an America first policy and then trying to just strike deals individually in a bilateral kind of way.
Mm-hmm. David Gergen, I see you shaking your head. Mixed messages here, growing pains. What did you think?
More than growing pains. You know, the President of the United States has now declared the press reporters to be the enemies of the people. Just an awful, awful charge. He talks all the time about fake news and how the press is full of fake news. Why then does he spend so damn much time watching television news? It's a mystery. And, you know, he ought to be turning off his TV set, turning off his Twitter account, and settling down and reading the briefings that were being prepared for him, which were longer and more authoritative, rather than watching television news, getting snippets of things from, say, like Sweden, going out and completely misstating the facts about what he just watched. It is not helpful to his presidency. At the very moment he's getting a really good heavyweight team in place on national security, this is a perfect moment for him to settle down and take more seriously the responsibilities of the job.
Mm. Juliet, I wonder, and you know, I also see that you reacting there. Because there are, in intelligence briefings, there would have been information about an attack in Sweden or a terror attack, or the actual numbers about what's happening when it comes to immigrants or migrants in Sweden and as it relates to crime. And those intelligence briefings probably have none of that in them because the facts just don't bear out.
That's exactly right. I mean, we don't know to the extent to which President Trump is getting his intelligence briefings. I bet you my life that they differ than something on Tucker Carlson's show. And so what the president needs to do, he has this apparatus available to him to understand a very complicated world that's not transactional and that's not binary, right? I mean, you know, it's not, we don't love Australia or hate Australia. I mean, the fact that Australia was the first conflict shows that he just views the world in this binary way, and it's much more complicated than that. Look, today's President's Day. And I think what sort of all presidents have been, and what I hope for this president, because is they've been curious. They've been curious about a world that they are, you know, the leader of the greatest country. And I think that curiosity really needs to be a part of the way that Trump manages a pretty good, at least, national security team. And once again, we don't have to agree with everything, so that we can begin to align our needs and our safety and security with what the rest of the world needs. Because, look, let me just remind everyone, this administration has not faced a real crisis yet. All of this news, there hasn't been a terrorist attack, a hurricane, a war, nothing yet. So we better maybe take this time to learn from the past and to learn from other nations and history so that we are prepared, because he is going to face it relatively soon.
Panel, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Coming